So we saw in when we had a discussion on the general rules of interpretation, we discussed in substantial detail the general rule of interpretation 5, right, which pretty much says that if the stuff are being, if there is a container, right, which is normally comes with that product, you do not need to break out special classification for that container because it kind of blends in or merges with that product. So when you classify it, you only need to provide one HTSUS line item. Now, HTS reporting requirement, however, in addition on the 7501, you also have to provide a monetary value. You have to declare the value, right? And of course, while you can merge under the HTSUS that container, right, provided that it is usual container, you also have to keep in mind that that you cannot avoid the value, right? So usually the value of the container packaging, because the containers also cost money, it kind of merges with that article under the general rule of interpretation 5. Now, what's in the context of NAFTA, you have packages, and especially packages for retail sale. And they carry some value, and they have to. You have to figure out that once you have that package as a value, you are dealing with a tariff shifting, because a lot of packaging, especially nowadays, they will not meet origination criteria because a lot of stuff is really made in China. Once you have that, you have to understand that. The value itself, you may be required to go through the tariff shifting. And once you are required to go through the tariff shifting, there may be regional value content requirement. So the question is, what do I do with the packaging? Do I include it or exclude it? And this rule clarifies of what to do. Specifically, if you have a retail sale, and the retail sale is the key, and if it is classified with the product, that packaging, you can disregard the value of that packaging in determining whether or not whether all of non-originating materials are used in the production undergo applicable tariff classification. In other words, you don't have to include it in your calculation formula, even though you may be tempted to, because the general rule of interpretation 5 says that it kind of merges in with that tariff number. So let's see how customs examiners test you on this. When determining whether the good undergoes an applicable change in tariff classification, so they invite you to the tariff shifting methodology and the general note 12T, counter-origin purposes, you should disregard. So a foreign component of a product found in chapter 15 that is less than 7%. All right, recall that. So of course, retail packaging here is the focus, right? You should disregard retail packaging because you are not because of this packaging for retail sale rule under general note 12J. But this question is not only valuable for its retail packaging question, which is the correct answer choice here, but it is also valuable in the process of elimination, because it takes you on a journey of those de minimis exceptions that we just discussed over here, which will not disqualify the product from de minimis. So recall that general rule for de minimis is 7%. It's general. Now, chapter 15, If it's less than 7%, you're good. But what about chapter 15 stuff? Well, we'll take a look at the exceptions over here. So you have a non-originating material provided for Section 15 of the tariff schedule should be, it does not apply to the general rule. So you can't use that as an argument, right? So therefore, chapter 15, there is no 7% rule de minimis. So this makes A an incorrect answer. B, an NAFTA apparel product where a material does not undergo a change in tariff classification, but is not more 7% of the total value of the product. So it looks like it fits that 7% rule, right? But recall with textiles, what we usually have is not 7% of the total value, but 7% of the total weight. We go with the weight. So here, it's an incorrect statement of law. It must be 7% of weight, not value, making B also incorrect answer choice. Well, C we discussed already in certain point. Let's go to D. Unassembled components of that product. Well, unassembled components, here we are going into the GRIs, right? So general rule of interpretation says any reference to article incomplete or fission, or incomplete or unfinished, here, unassembled, disassembled, here. Any reference to heading that includes reference to incomplete and unfinished, it includes to the whole article, provided that it has essential character of a complete or finished article. So, provided as entered, the incomplete or a finished article has the essential character of complete or finished article. This rule is also applicable to articles entered unassembled or disassembled. So, in other words, general rule 2A says, and we are in classification now, we are not in NAFTA, but it has implications. Whenever you classify, it has implications because when you engage in a tariff shifting methodology, you're looking at the essential character rule here. And we have several essential character rule, the essential rule character rule under 2A, and we also have essential character rule under 2B. I'm sorry, under 3B, right? Over here. So this means that once you have just a second. All right, so this means that once you have the product which meets that general, let's see, this means that, going back to the question, so once you have essential character, it implies that you meet that, you go with the, with whatever that unassembled components of the product are made as if they were assembled. Right, so this one is not responsive to the question. In determining whether good undergoes applicable change in tariff classification, you cannot disregard unassembled components because if they are, you have to look at the essential character, and if they are assembled, then it will qualify the product for NAFTA or not qualify, depending on the tariff shifting analysis. So D is incorrect. E, cooked currant jelly. Let's see. All right, so we have cooked currant jelly, where an ingredient does not meet the change in tariff classification, but is 5% of the value of the good. All right, this one is more difficult to rule out, but we can give it a try. So classification for currant jelly is 2007-99-15 is classification for currant, and 2007-99-70 for jelly. One way we can double check that is by going into the HTS tables. All right, so here we have currant, right? And by going down to the 70, we have fruit jellies, all right? Now, here comes the interesting part. If we go to the de minimis rule, we have this subparagraph 5, right? It does not apply to originating material used in the production of the good provided for in chapters 1 through 27, inclusive of the schedule, unless the non-originating material is provided for in a different subheading than the good in which origin has been determined under this note. What does it mean? In simple words, if subheading is this, this is our subheading. If this subheading is the same as this subheading for this product, which is used in the production of this product, then the note, the de minimis is not applicable. So using the case study of the currant being used in the preparation of currant jelly, same subheading, so there is no shift, no de minimis. So, because no de minimis, 5% is not helpful. Therefore, E is not a correct answer choice. So, this is a good example of not only retail packaging, which was a call of a question, but also of all the stuff that are testing you on the exception of de minimis. I think it's a great question, and I think the analysis of this, the elimination analysis of this, is even more important than getting the straight to the point retail packaging. Although if you can do that, you'll be fine too.